Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Martin. I'm very excited to be here. I've been blown away by the number of creative people, you know, here at Polis. If you have a quick look behind me, the number of new ideas, new groundbreaking, world-changing ideas is just staggering. And I was really a bit curious. Why is it that this place is so creative? How come? Well, to think, I think we have to go back a little, well, quite a little back to 1992. Because in 1992 was the year the Velvet Divorce in the Czech Republic, but it was also the year Snow Crash was released. It was a book by Neil Stephenson, and it was the first mention of digital cash. The world was a mess, hyperinflation, and people used digital cash in his science fiction novel at the time to basically bypass the inflation and taxes. Well, sounds familiar. For a lot of people it does, because it does look a bit like Bitcoin. 1992 was also the year I started studying computer science in Amsterdam. And one of the companies there, one of the startup companies I worked for, we were working on, you know, first sites basically for the World Wide Web. But there was one key component missing, and I was accepting payments on the World Wide Web. Basically, it was brochureware, as I called it. You could send and share information, but there was no proper way to do e-commerce. Actually, e-commerce, I think it wasn't even invented, the quote. 1992 was also the year that a lot of people, where I grew up, we played video games. While here in the Czech Republic, people played computer games. You know, you would pirate a game and then, you know, run it on your Commodore 64, type load and stuff, and it would never load, so you had to go back and debug. I think this is part of the reason why we see so much creativity here in the Czech Republic, because the generation that grew up with video games in the part of the world where I grew up, we were basically raising a generation of consumers, you know, people that play some games that just stick in a cartridge and they would be playing a game. While over here, if you wanted to play a game, you actually had to load the program into the computer first. You had to copy the tape from somebody else because it probably wouldn't sell it. So this difference is, it looks like a tiny little difference, but I think this is part of the reason why the Czech Republic now is so powerful in creating things. We've seen amazing ideas, really, and a lot of hardware hacking too. Where I come from, we don't really do hardware. We don't even have factories anymore. So when you want to create something, you'll have to make it in China, and probably you'll find out that 2 weeks later, it will be sold on eBay without your brand name on it at a reduced price, which you can't match because, hey, 1992 was also the year I started studying computer science. But as a student, I was always strapped on cash. So what do you do? You had to get some money in. So I worked at a startup. It took two more years for our neighbors, because we were the only we were situated in the only building in Amsterdam at the time that had super fast 1 megabit internet connection. We were paying through the roof for the connection, but we had internet connection permanent on. And then in 1995, we still didn't have any e-commerce. We got new neighbors called DigiCash. Actually, the product was eCash, but the company was called DigiCash. It was founded by David Chaum, brilliant cryptographer, who invented blinded signatures, a way to provide anonymity. You still see these features today, not eCash, but you still see the use of the blinded signatures today, and every time you go online and you see the SSL lock, or the TLS or SSL lock, go on in your browser, it's basically the same technology. At that time, our office, we had to pay using DigiCash, so it was like a closed loop system. We would basically pay using eCash for our fax machine, our Bounty, Snickers, Mars, all the candies and the sodas from the machines. We would use it to pay for phone and coffee. And actually it was working quite well as a cryptographic digital cash type of system. Except that it had some problems. Problems being, it could only have one issuer, meaning you'd have Deutsche Bank cash, Parallelnik Poly cash, or anything. It would be a closed loop system, which of course we know with Bitcoin this is not the case. But that was then. Eventually, DigiCash folded. Why did it fold? I personally think it's because consumers preferred credit cards. We all know credit cards are not secure, especially not in e-commerce. We didn't really like credit cards. But it was the consumer that said, I will use a credit card instead of DigiCash. Well, what was the reasoning behind this? And this is where I think it's very similar to Bitcoin. Because eCash was quite hard to use. People had to have like some hardware, a card, where they, you know, connected to the computer. It was already 1995 by then, the year of Windows 95, but also the year that e-commerce started flourishing. But consumers, as we got more and more people online, we noticed that the level of sophistication of the people on that internet, it dropped. It was very hard to tell people or to convince people that they would need to use e-cash as opposed to a credit card. Why? Because of security. Well, they weren't that sophisticated, all those new users. They were all on AOL and many of those providers. They saw the numbers grow, but the level of sophistication really dropped. And I see a similarity with Bitcoin. The first Bitcoiners, they were highly technical and creative. While we see now a lot of Bitcoiners now, they just see it as a quick rich scheme. And they're not very sophisticated. They don't really get this technology. And this is also something I think we need to work on for Bitcoin. Because if we look at the parallels for the eCash story back then and Bitcoin now, there's been many, many, many other different eCash type of systems, like eGold, Liberty Reserve, but they never really made it past this gaming stage. Why didn't that happen? Why didn't eGold and Liberty Reserve just grow up like Bitcoiners? In my opinion, it's because there was no infrastructure. And as such, no infrastructure, no payment terminals, no ATMs, no nothing, no APIs, very limited. This caused, you know, it just hindered adoption. But with Bitcoin now, we see a totally different situation. We've got our ATMs, we've got point of sale terminals, NFC chip implants, everything we need to have successful infrastructure. Except that one thing, that the number of people using Bitcoin is still growing, but the level of sophistication is dropping. So to all you makers out here, whenever you create something for Bitcoin, or any other cryptocurrency for that matter, make sure it's user-friendly. Try it on the non-suspecting user that never tried Bitcoin before. Yesterday there was a lady from the ARD here. And she was totally confused by Bread Wallet on iOS. We know a Bread Wallet. A wallet is not that hard to use. But from a beginner's perspective, it's really difficult to grasp the idea. Private key, public key, everything. How do I restore my wallets and all those things. And I think it's therefore important that if you create an application for a cryptocurrency, or for Bitcoin or any of the other one out there, that you focus on the user experience, make it easy to use. So there's a bit about the history. Flash forward a bit to 2013. I was living in Amsterdam again, and I read this thing about Bitcoin ATM machines. So I thought, this is perfect. I need to have one of those Bitcoin ATM machines, because it will make our virtual currency more tangible, easier to grasp for normal people. And one of the nights I was walking home, I was walking through the red light district, not just walking. I live in the area, just don't get me wrong on that. But I saw two bouncers at one of the strip clubs say, "Oh, there's a Bitcoin ATM machine down the road." "A what?" the guy said. yes, Bitcoin ATM machine, you know, this virtual cash thing. I say, well, how does it look? What do you get out of this ATM? How does it look? How does a Bitcoin, what does it look like? Because the whole idea of what a Bitcoin is, they didn't have an idea. So by placing the ATMs, I thought it would help make it more visible and less virtual. You know, make it more visible and help people to understand the technology. Because after all, if they put a tenner in or a fiver in, and they put real money in and they get this virtual money out, and all of a sudden this virtual money on their phone is like real money to them, because after all, they put it in there. And especially in the beginning, we had this machine from BTC-O-Matic, which was a rebranded Russian kiosk type of thing. It was huge. It had two screens. We used the top screen to tell people what Bitcoin was and how to use the machine, and the bottom screen would just have, well, most of the time it would just give an error because it was a rebranded Windows-based ATM. I mean, really, you know, we wouldn't touch it nowadays, but back then it was the only stuff I could get my hands on. So for me, that was it was good fun, except I spent most of my time debugging and problem solving, because almost every transaction would fail. There would always be manual interaction required. So when in 2014, Bitcoin 2014 Expo was in Amsterdam at the time, we brought our ATM, and it was a 3-day conference, but we spent 2 days trying to get the machine to work. And then the third day, I just gave up. I just gave up on the ATM. I went partying, just like all the other guys. So I learned that this ATM thing, to make it work, we really needed a higher uptime and a better quality software. So when I met Karel from General Bytes at the time, and he had the ATM, and I was excited about the small ATM, the yellow one. I believe there's one at Paper Hub here at Parallelny Polis. But I was so excited, I thought, I have to try that one. So when I got my machines delivered, it came with a note. Dear customer, you are my very first customer. Everything will not work as expected. Please be patient. So I was freaking out. I thought, oh no, this is going to be a BTC-O-Matic story again. But it didn't. It worked brilliantly. It worked brilliantly from day one. So this is where we really finally managed to get some revenue out of the ATM. You know, actually this ATM was working when the client would approach, and they wouldn't really have to call me first to make sure that the Bitcoins would eventually be delivered. I ordered a couple of other ATMs and started to think about what other applications can we create for Bitcoin. So I created a notary service. I used that to basically give proof of attendance to people who participated in one of our blockchain courses or Bitcoin courses. And this way we would register or proof of existence on the blockchain. But I made a big mistake there. I used somebody else's API. And while that's perfectly normal in programming, it's not when you build a house. Like, for example, if you would build a house, you wouldn't build it in your neighbor's garden. You would at least own the land where you build your house on. In programming, that's not so evident. So what happened is that all those apps I created over time, they lasted for half a year, maybe a bit longer, but eventually they would all die because the API provider didn't have a business model. In that respect, I think if you do create a Bitcoin application or cryptocurrency application for the matter, and you rely on third-party APIs, do check whether they will be around next month. One of the large API providers, I believe chain.com, they look like really like solid as there to stay. But at one point they just disappeared. They were bought up by banks, and now they're into banking, and they help the R3 consortium. So not much support for the Bitcoin community. And then I started thinking, what is the most single important thing we need to make Bitcoin succeed? In my opinion, it's infrastructure. We need to have the infrastructural components there, like Lego for blockchains, Bitcoin blockchain in my case. But if we create stuff, we need to create something that we can run and control ourselves. We can't rely too much on third-party APIs. Unless, of course, you know that they will be around next year, but they won't even know themselves. So in this Bitcoin space, it's kind of like important if you want to have any business continuity to make sure that all the components are there and working. Because you can't go to an investor and say, can you please invest 100,000 euros? Because I built this world-changing, life-changing system and it runs on the Bitcoin blockchain and we use this crazy API. Because by the time you get the money, a few months later, the API provider stops. What happens? Your app is nowhere. So if people here in this room create applications and make sure you use a stable API, focus on the user experience too, because otherwise the less sophisticated users won't be able to, they won't be able to follow you. And they will, I think it's therefore very important that we focus on these two points. One of the things I also noticed is that a lot of people, they think about their crazy cryptocurrency idea and then they just start building it without doing any market research whatsoever. For this reason, I started, was one of the co-founders of the Bitcoin Embassy in Amsterdam. That was in 2014, yes. And we founded the Bitcoin Embassy with the sole goal of trying to unite people working with Bitcoin technology together and help them like connect to each other and see if they could, you know, work together to create something great. It's only then I found out that we don't really produce anything in the Netherlands. We can create an app. We might even design something, but eventually we'll probably have it made in China. And this, I think, is one of the strong points you have here in Prague or Czech Republic in general. It's one of the attendees told me yesterday, if you want to make it in the Czech Republic, you have to make something, produce something, forge steel, create something, you know? And this has been part of your history for such a long time. Where I grew up, if you want to make something, or you want to make it in life, you're not making something. You're buying something and you're selling it for a little bit more somewhere else. Basically, just trading. But that doesn't help us in this modern age, because more and more trading is going directly. So I think the real power is, the power here, is you have the capability to actually make stuff. And this is what I find so inspiring. Oh, that's a cute dog. This is what I find so inspiring here. And for example, I have a Tesla radio. It's almost 80 years old. I could have bought a Sonos off the shelf, but it's ugly. I have a tiny apartment. I can't have this Sonos sitting in my living room. So I bought this Tesla radio made in the Czech Republic, or I think it was Czechoslovakia at the time, because it was in 1938, just before the World War started. And it's still playing, okay. I must confess, I ripped all the guts out because it wasn't working. Put a Raspberry Pi in, so it plays Spotify, AirPlay, everything. But, you know, the device itself is still beautiful. After almost 80 years, it's beautiful to look at. It was designed here in the Czech Republic, and every time I walk past it, it has this eerie glow. I put some green LEDs in it, so it has this matrix-like glow. It just smiles at me. And this is why I think you have a very, very good design and production facilities. So if you work on something in the crypto or Bitcoin sphere, use this to your advantage, because you can't really have a product without a product. You can create an app, but you need to have some hardware product. Like for example, Trezor, I believe there's the ATM manufacturer here. Yeah. Well, yes, and many others. You know, just a quick look around at the Parallelny Polis, you see these fantastic things like the Instagraph, like the art installation, that the robo painter. I don't know, I forgot the name to be honest, but and many of those things show the possibility that you know how to combine hardware and software. And therefore, I think this is a strong point of the Czech Republic. Everybody here should think about that, that the fact that you are able to actually manufacture and design, but also create the software without having to travel half the globe to check up on the progress. So, for me, I've been blown away by the number of magnificent initiatives. And I can't really add much to it. I just can try and compare it to, you know, beginning of the internet in the early 90s. So, I think that there is a bright future. But if you constantly focus only on Bitcoin, you're missing the point. It's easy to think Bitcoin will change the world, especially if you're like living and working here in this area. I mean, you know, everybody uses Bitcoin in this, and this is the first time I actually see a place with 3 Bitcoin ATMs. I think this is unique in the world. If there's anybody that knows a place with that has 3 Bitcoin ATMs anywhere in the world, please interrupt me now, because I think this is kind of like special. And when I, in 2014, I thought, well, how am I going to keep my Bitcoin safe? At the time I was running the Bitcoin ATM collective. Of course we didn't have a bank account because the bank closed my accounts the moment they heard the word Bitcoin. I didn't expect that. Later on I could have expected it, but I didn't expect that. So we found a different solution. We would team up with miners or traders. They would fill our ATMs. We would take the cash out and would directly pay them, basically bypassing the entire standard banking system. This worked well, except I was concerned about theft. So one day, somewhere late 2013, this mate of mine, Amal Graafstra, he called me up and said, Martin, I'm working on something, and maybe you'll like it too. I want to start my car with a chip implant. I said, well, yeah, I'm living in the city, man, I don't use the car much. And he said, I want to open the house door with my chip implant. I said, oh, that's nice, but I live in an apartment block, pretty useless for me, so I'm not going to try it. But he said, how many bytes is the memory? He said, 868 bytes. So that's where I knew it. I wanted to create an offshore bank account in my body, because hey, all the offshore bank accounts are no more. We get monitored and we get checked. You can't even access your own money, which is kind of ridiculous if you think about it. So it was my responsibility, to keep somebody else's Bitcoin safe. So what? How are you going to do that? You know, I could print a paper wallet and I could go to the bank and say, please, can you store this in your safe? But I felt, you know, I would have lost it if I would have lost the race if I would have done that, because where we are going, we don't need no banks. So I'm not going to a bank to deposit my Bitcoins, definitely not. So this is why I thought the NFC implants will be a cool idea. I never expected any publicity around it. And it's only when a friend of mine who worked at Telegraph, the telegraph.co.uk, he did the technology section and he was writing about lithium ion batteries. So when you're on a Facebook test, I said, man, are you out of creativity? Talking about lifetime of lithium ion batteries. Try something new, you know, these chip implants. So he posted it on the Telegraph, and for 1 year, my phone didn't stop ringing. I eventually changed the phone number because I got so sick and tired of it all the time. But it went all over the world. I never expected this tiny little thing to have such an impact. But I think it helped. It helped Bitcoin adoption in a way that people know now that they can keep their Bitcoin safe and they can take their Bitcoins wherever they travel without having to declare them. Actually, the chip doesn't even show up on body scanners. So I got a lot of views out of Colombia on my YouTube video, which I don't know. I don't really understand why, but I guess there's plenty of people looking for ways to securely store their money. And this, I thought, was a good idea. I didn't expect the whole industry to respond. Like, now we can pay a Red Bull by just waving our hands. We can pay for our coffee by just waving our hands. But it requires infrastructure. So it requires some little bits of hardware. And that's where we get back at the whole situation here. It's you're in a unique position to create the hardware. There's plenty of creative thinkers here. And I think you should, you know, treasure your inner geek and just create. But do your market research in advance, because there are not that many Bitcoiners. It's hard to believe if you walk around here and everybody has their wallets and everything. But it is a website called ChangeTip. Most of you probably heard of it. It's like with the little head. If you like an article, you can give some tip instead of a like, and that, you know, helps, you know, Bitcoin adoption. But one of the early investors in ChangeTip told me the developments in ChangeTip went dramatically, super fast. Everything went as expected. It's exponential growth, investors happy, everything. Until they hit the 200,000 mark. There were no people signing up anymore. There was nobody wanted, either they didn't like ChangeTip anymore, or what it turned out to be, there were not many more Bitcoin websites. So every single website used ChangeTip at that time. So then we found out that there's a limited market for the products we make now. Therefore, if you do create an application that runs on Bitcoin, look at it from a broader perspective. Just don't make it only work on Bitcoin. Try to see if you can make it with other cryptocurrencies too. Maybe even the private blockchains that some companies are now creating. I'm not very much a fan of private blockchains, but I think every one of them has their advantages. For example, if you have a project where you need privacy, but you still want to use the blockchain-like technology, then yes, you can only get a private blockchain. But if you want it to be open standard and everybody should be able to use it, then just use the Bitcoin blockchain or make some tokens on the Ethereum blockchain. But realize that by just creating the software, it will not work. You'll need some hardware. So if you create a hardware solution, make sure it works with all the different cryptocurrencies you can possibly think of and the ones you want to do in the future, or at least with a little bit of a modification, because then your market will automatically be bigger than the 200,000 users we have now. I don't think there's more users, there's 200,000 websites, but I roughly think there's like 500,000 Bitcoin users worldwide now. If anybody thinks I'm wrong in that, just please correct me. But therefore, if we want to grow Bitcoin, we will find that the level of sophistication of the average Bitcoin user will drop, just like it did with the World Wide Web. And they will not necessarily see Bitcoin as something they need, and they might even, you know, not like using it, because a lot of people find it complicated. So the trick is to make it easy to use. And this, I can't stress this enough, make it easy to use. So this way, even, you know, try ask your mom if she can use it, you know. And I think once you do that, you'll find out that the market for your product will increase. And in 2014, it was almost 2015, we created the Bitcoin Embassy in Amsterdam, because we didn't have a place like this, like Parallel Nipolis, and there was no real, it was just a monthly meetup going on, but there was no regular meetup of people that, you know, create a crowd, you know, share ideas and make stuff. So we created the Bitcoin Embassy with the sole purpose of basically uniting the Bitcoin community, try to get programmers together, try to get enthusiasts together, get media, and basically work together to create a better ecosphere. In a way, I failed. I found out that there were just not many programmers. There are lots of people that want Bitcoin and they want to know more about Bitcoin. There weren't that many people actually programming for Bitcoin. So, especially not compared to here. But what I did find out is that media-wise, it did help to have a single point of contact. And I think for Parallel Nipolis, it's kind of the same. If people in the Czech Republic, if there's media in the Czech Republic that wants to know about Bitcoin, I assume the first thing they do is just go for a coffee here and ask people. And I'm not sure where the future will bring us, but I think the lessons learned from the beginning of the web do apply more or less to Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies as well. If I'm not even sure what I'll be doing next year this time, but I hope that we will be able to start more hardware projects, because I think the real way to make Bitcoin successful is to build infrastructure, just Lego for blockchains. And even though we might prefer Bitcoin, just look at it from a broader perspective. You can't really expect entire countries to switch to Bitcoin. People will switch to Bitcoin. If you give them an option, if their country is failing and have hyperinflation, yes, Bitcoin is a good option. But in countries with a relative stable currency, like the Czech Republic, or stable currency, I shouldn't mention the euro in that case, but okay, the euro, there's no real need for Bitcoin. And even though it's better and far superior than our current financial system, the average consumer will still prefer the easy way to use it. So if we want Bitcoin to be successful, just focus on that user experience. And that's basically what I really, really want to stress. A lot of the Bitcoin companies, I found, at least in the Netherlands, they start designing stuff because they like doing what they do. I totally understand that from a geek perspective. But if there is no market for it, then how are you going to sell your product? One of the attendees here at the conference told me yesterday, the Skyhook ATMs. Does anybody remember the Skyhook ATMs here in the crowd? They were like the small $1,000 ATMs. They were really cheap. And it would revolutionize the way we get our Bitcoins. Well, it didn't. Why not? Because the makers were totally mistaken how many ATMs they would actually sell. So on that $1,000 ATM, they made a $250 profit. So to pay the rent, you can calculate how many ATMs you have to sell each single week. Well, if they would have done their homework, they would have realized there is no market for so many ATMs, well, at this moment. And this basically caused them the business to fail. The rest was great, it was a nice product, well, it wasn't, it was a cheap ATM, So it didn't accept anything like 50 euro bills or higher, because it just wouldn't fit in the machine itself. So there were plenty of limitations. It was not just marketing, that they didn't look at that market research, but they also made certain mistakes, which, they were looking at from a US market only perspective. Yes, it would accept all dollar bills, and no, it would not accept all euro bills. So this was one mistake they made. But the market research, I know everybody hates doing market research because it just stops you from developing your product, but I think it's really important. So once we got an intern last year at the Bitcoin Embassy, and he was saying, like, what do I have to do? I said, please do some market research. Make the biggest Bitcoin market research to date and see how many people will actually respond and what's the level of sophistication. And we found that not that many people use Bitcoin. So without being an early investor in ChangeTip, we already found out that the market is limited and the market will remain limited. But there will always be a market. So if you adjust your pricing, your development, and everything to that market, you'll have a flourishing business. But if you ignore that market and you create something, well, they won't scale, because like the €250 profit on $250 profit on the ATMs, that didn't scale. You can't sell ATMs like muffins. You have to. It's a difficult business, and therefore I think that in order for Bitcoin to succeed, every one of us, I believe most of us here are makers or programmers or one way or the other creative people, just do your market research. If you use an API from a third party, make sure they're around next month. You'll never know. You'll never really get an answer on that, because they'll say that we've got plenty of money, we'll be around until Bitcoin dies. But in reality, you can figure it out. If they don't charge you any money for using the API, where's this money coming from? Yes, they'll make the money later. Guess what? Usage of the API grows, the costs grow, managing the API, still no business plan. Okay, pull the plug. And at the same time, they're pulling the plug of all those nice Bitcoin businesses that popped up and use their API. So your market research, make sure if you rely on third-party APIs that you can trust them that they'll be around next month. Preferably, do everything yourself. Don't use a third-party API, but that's not always possible. You know, it's difficult to make a Bitcoin application. It's rather complicated. I mean, instead of looking at the transaction ID, you have to count your inputs and outputs, which makes it the more complicated for a novice crypto programmer. So we do need APIs, but if you create an API, try to build it so that the users can run it on their own server, so that even when you're no longer there as a company, the products that were generated using your infrastructure will continue to thrive. I think that's about it, really. That's about it. If there's any questions, please let me know.
Okay, so I will ask, what do you see as the most promising areas right now in terms of the usability of Bitcoin? Because you are right that it's the most important thing for the development of Bitcoin right now.
Especially in the early stages of Bitcoin, we saw that, well, we see Bitcoin as money. We use it here as money, but you see now in a new generation of cryptocurrency enthusiasts, they see it as, if Bitcoin is like a glass of water, a water glass. They don't see it as a water glass. You know, you can use a glass to construct things. So basically, you try to think out of the box, create something that's like not so obvious money-like. I mean, a notary service, for example, or a lottery service. I think there's a huge market for anything decentralized. If you follow the news, you'd seen that in the US currently online gambling is going to be restricted. You can argue whether that's, you know, whether that has any effect, but it does have an effect because people in the US going to an online casino, charging their credit card, they'll find that the credit card is blocked next week. So that's development where I think Bitcoin will be big. If Bitcoin, if the first person to build a decentralized casino will be big. But as I said, I'm not a gambler. I think gambling is like a full stack. You know, you should, the only winning move is not to play. But it will be around regardless. So by just look, try to identify opportunities where Bitcoin could add value, or Bitcoin or blockchain technology could add value. Did that answer your question?
Yeah, kind of.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Next question. No questions. I'm sure that Martin would love to answer any question, even unrelated to the talk.
Yes, I'm available for questions anytime if any one of you have.
You have to raise your hand.
So, as a young user of Bitcoin, I'm kind of surprised that nobody of people of my age is using Bitcoin. What do you think? Why is the reason that young people of my age, I'm 17 right now, and I don't know anyone of my age who'd use Bitcoins, why is it like that?
I think it's primarily because of the user experience. Okay, I'm used to using, I'm used to my mycelium wallet, but it's kind of daunting and it's not user friendly, and that is a very, you know, why would you bother if you don't see the need? Because we see the need for privacy and for anonymous digital cash, but the other end users out there might not necessarily see that. So why would they bother if they already have the credit card? So, you know, it has to be added value. There should be added value to any product you make in Bitcoin. For example, if you that's not a good example. But the thing is, I think it's usability. That's the primary reason why people shun Bitcoin. I mean, Most people find it complicated and daunting, and even though I spend a lot of time trying to explain Bitcoin to others, I find it daunting at times. I lost a lot of money at Mt. Gox and all the other, with Phoenix recently, and many other payment processors that went under. Every time, people lose money, and there's nobody giving you the money back, so why would I bother as a novice user with Bitcoin, because I'll probably lose all my coins. So we have to reassure the users that they can always restore their Bitcoins, like Trezor did with the wallet's 12-word passphrase. You can always get your Bitcoins back. People say, oh, I need another Trezor then. That's for this reason I have three of them at home. You know, if any one of them dies, I always have a spare Trezor. So I can always access my coins. And this gives me the confidence to use Bitcoin, because I know that I'll get my Bitcoins back if the device itself fails. And I think this is something whatever crypto, blockchain, like project you do, or Bitcoin project, make sure it's user-friendly, easy to use. Try it on family member that really hates Bitcoin. If they think, oh, this is easy, then it will be a success. It will not necessarily be a success, but it might become a success. I think the NFC implant I created at the time with Amal, I never expected there to be so much negative publicity about it. It's not been great for Bitcoin in that respect, because there were a lot of people saying, oh, it's the end of times is near and you're the devil. I didn't get that. I've never been brought up with any religion. My parents said, if you want to believe, you select your own religion when you grow up, but right now we don't do that here at home. So I've never understood this whole mark of the beast thing. But if I would have done some research, I would have probably found out that maybe it would have been better to put it in my arm instead of my hand. So, sometimes you just don't know what the response will be from the public. So therefore, I think do test and do ask around, do your market research every time you create a new blockchain application or Bitcoin application. Did I answer your question a bit?
Yeah.
Focus on the usability, the user friendliness, and do check if there is even a market for your product. Because in a lot of cases, you find there's no market. I mean, we see with a limited number of Bitcoin users. You know, is it good enough to keep the company running? And this is why I like the Trezor too. I call this Trezor thing multiple times because I think it's a nice example. It's like, you know, made here. Or, well, you don't know if it's made here, but it's definitely designed here. And one of the things I really like about the Trezor is that they go beyond Bitcoin. They look beyond Bitcoin. Sure, you have your Bitcoin wallet, but I can also use it, I actually use it quite a lot, to authenticate myself on a WordPress website. With a little plugin, your Bitcoin wallet can also become a two-factor authentication, which is magnificent, because how many people use Bitcoin? Well, we just found out 200,000 to 500,000. And how many people need two-factor authentication that is easy to use? Well, that is a huge market. So by just looking beyond the basic blockchain wallet, Bitcoin wallet requirements, and by thinking we could use this for two-factor authentication, they basically created a whole new market. And I think if you create anything with Bitcoin or blockchain, try to broaden the market so you get more product appeal from different sections. And it will probably mean the difference between a success and a failure.
Thank you very much for the answer.
Hi.
Thank you for the talk. So I wanted to ask you if you could elaborate on the implants and where is it going, what's the development, how is it safe in terms of hacking, for example, and such?
The implants, I got a lot of criticism about, because people said there's not enough security on an NFC chip and it's just like the security of a car key, it will not be enough. But in my case, I just ignored the basic security that's in the chips. It's like 40-bit encryption, which is comparable to a car key. So I just opted to, like, my left hand stores a BIP38 encrypted key, At first, it was a bit difficult to get the key out, so I talked to the guys at Mycelium at the time, and they modified their app so it would accept Bitcoin URI, Bitcoin colon, and then an encrypted BIT38 encrypted private key, so that at least, you know, when I swipe it, it will ask for a password. So this, I thought, was the security I needed to protect large sums of Bitcoin. On the other hand, if you want to make a payment here, you want to make a contactless payment, there's no point in having to enter a password at the point of sale terminal to pay for your coffee. So for small amounts, it makes no sense to have that encryption. So therefore, in my right hand, I just keep the petty cash, you know, coffee cash, Red Bull cash, you know, this is, and the only thing missing is I should be able to do this and then transfer from there to there. I still need the phone for that. That is a bit of an issue, I think. But in terms of where we're going, I can reveal a bit. We're currently working, Mauro Grafsa is working, Dangerous Things, the company that makes them. He's working on a new version. Unfortunately, it will not be so tiny as this one. It was quite large because a lot of people complained about the bad reception of the key. So, the bad reception of the NFC chip. But the prime reason for that is it's like 12 millimeters long. Half of the capsule is used for the antenna, and the other half is the chip. So you can't harvest much energy with such a tiny antenna. But it was basically a bug, or, you know, it was a problem with those chips. But for me, that was not a problem. It was a solution to not be able, you know, I didn't have to encrypt it, because you really have to fiddle a bit before you find it. And even then, you know, you have to know that there is an implant. So the lack of proper reception was one of the key features, basically, in being able to make it a Bitcoin wallet. So sometimes, you know, it might sound like a negative thing, but you can use it in a positive way. The new model, however, will have a larger, it will not be, you know, you won't be able to just inject it. It will need thermal lifting. So they'll lift up, they'll cut it, they'll lift up your skin and then put it underneath. I'm sorry, but that just freaks me out for now, you know. I hope Amal fixes that a bit. But it's got a larger antenna, the chip is different, it's got a Java card, so anybody that can program Java and is familiar with the Java card API will be able to program apps on there. So instead of just using it as a storage, like a post-it with different records, you'll be able to emulate other cards, emulate your public transport card, emulate bank cards, emulate anything. But you can also create more sophisticated Bitcoin wallets this way. So I think the future will be bright, but the future will be painful because it will be a lot larger. So I think for now, these current chips, you know, this is, for me, that's okay. And I noticed there's a whole army of cyborgs running around here at Paradelny Polis, and I think they'll agree with me that the little chip is large enough. So yes, that's the roadmap. We expect to launch in a few months the new chip. I'm not sure if the current dealers and distributors will be able to also implant that, because it will require a bit of a dermal lift, which is kind of like a bit, for me it's a bit painful. On the other hand, all the cool biohacking things are like too large to use in a syringe, so it, you know. So the guy who put the chip implants in, I had problems finding somebody that would do it, because there was nobody doing the chip implants at the time. So when I got my syringe, it was a huge syringe, I took it to my doctor. I said, doctor, you have to help me. You need to put the chip in my arm. And he started laughing at my face, and I got a little bit aggravated. You know, it's like, why are you laughing at my face? I just asked, you are the doctor, you put the chip in my arm. You know, I'm the client, you're my doctor. Actually, I paid for the consult, so. He said, no, you get it wrong. I'm a doctor. I fix you when you're sick. You're not sick, get out of my office. So I said, I'll find somebody else. He said, yeah, right, you will be back. And that time I will be helping you, meaning like you'll totally screw up. So I went to just about every tattoo artist in Amsterdam, and they looked at me and they're like, no, not going to do that. And then the piercing studios, many piercing studios, but none of them would even touch it. But I had printed out the instructions, like, you know, just lift the skin, put the needle in, pull it back 10 millimeters, press the eject button, and it will be there. Now, they just didn't want to do it. So eventually I found a the body manipulation artist. I didn't know such a thing would exist, but these people specialized in little implants and dermal lifts, and you know, when he's like, instead of going to a party to dance, the guy hangs himself on hooks, so pain is not an issue for him. And he was said, "Oh yeah, I'll put a chip in." So we started a biohacking meetup, and we found an old factory, old toothpaste factory, a bit like this. And in the basement, we just cleaned it up a bit because it have to work hygienically. And we had 20 people, and we all chipped, experiments. Like, what are we going to do? Oh yes, we're going to put the chip in and meet later. How did we use that chip? Some people just thought, oh, it's crazy, I want to have this chip, but then never used it. Well, for one, because they didn't have an Android telephone, they had an Apple phone. So yeah, well, pretty useless then. So I helped them put their business card in, which is pretty useless. But I do use the business card trick as well. Right now, this is my spending money for the coffee, but there's not many places where you can actually buy your drinks with coffee, like in Paralelny Polis. Yes, I put my business card in because it has one big advantage. If you meet all these people on a conference and they say, oh, do you have a business card? I say, oh, you can scan my hand. You've got one advantage over giving them a business card. Why? Because you get the business card back from them. So when you call them, you're already in their phone. While it would normally be one of those numbers you don't recognize, the numbers I usually don't pick up, because I keep picking up the phone in that case. So this is really, it gives you just a little advantage, because you call them, first time you call them, and your name is already in their phone. So this really helped me grow my network. Actually, it helped me a lot. And for the rest, I use it as a snooze button for my alarm clock. Anyone of you has an implant and an Android phone, all you need to do is download Sleep as Android. It's this fantastic app. It's somewhere, I don't know where it's from, but the guy has been working on it for years. It monitors your sleep and all this stuff. It's really nice. Puts all your sleep hours in your Google Calendar, so it looks really nice in your schedule. But one of the things he added, I asked him to edit, can I please snooze my alarm with the NFC? And ever since that app upgrade, I've never slept late again, because it takes a bit of fiddling, and by the time you're in the morning, switch off the alarm, and if you're really still not awake, you won't be able to properly scan your chip. So for me, it helps. It helped me get more productive. Other application I use it for is KeePass. Everybody here probably knows KeePass. It's this app you use on any platform. You store all your passwords in. You only have to remember one large passphrase, and then you can access your passwords anywhere, which is fantastic. But it's a bit of a hassle on the mobile phone, because you have to type this very long password. Mine is so long, it's just impossible to it's impossible to type on a mobile phone. I always make an error. So by basically storing half of your passphrase or encrypted part of the passphrase on the phone, the other half goes into the chip implant. People will not be able to decrypt your passwords if they would just scan with their phone, but with your phone you'll be able to decrypt your passwords. Actually, it saves me a lot of typing every time I need a password. And unfortunately, I do need a password now and then, because you get an upgrade from the Google Play Store, and all of a sudden Facebook no longer knows who you are. You have to log in again. And I don't ever reuse passwords. I think this is bad operational security. So I have different passwords for every website I've ever visited or registered on. But it amounts to what, 1600 current passwords. I can't remember those. So this is why I use the chip. It's just one of the applications, and I think people will be able to, it's a personal thing. It's like a tattoo or a piercing. You just find whatever works best for you. And although the possibilities are limited with 868 bytes in the current model, as I said, the future models will have Java built in, so you can really create cool applications. So yes, I do. I think the future is bright in that respect, yes.
Thank you very much for the answer and for your talk.